الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The title of today's speech is Developing and Maintaining an Islamic Personality. Allah has blessed us with the religion of Islam. And as Muslims, Allah expects certain things of us. We are expected to be Muslim in every way. And we are expected to live by Islam, to observe Islam, and to implement Islam in every sense of the word. Unfortunately, in today's day and age, having been so heavily influenced by other cultures, other attitudes, of ideologies, many Muslims all over the world have developed this mentality and this approach to religion that our religion is no different to any other. And just as adherents to other faiths believe in and observe their religion, we do exactly the same. So if you take Christianity, even someone who is considered to be a devout Christian, not a nominal one, but a devout, practicing, observant Christian, what does he do? He goes to church once a week. And that's a very, very devout job. He goes to church once a week. That's on his chosen holy day of Sunday. The attitude is that you go to church once a week. You go in, you hymn your praises, you sing your hymns, you do your worship. You reconcile yourself with God. You make your peace with God. And then you come away. Having attended that one church service, you've purified yourself and cleansed yourself for the rest of the week. Now you can go and sin again for another 6 days. And once you come out of the church, there's nothing else to do. No other act of worship. Nothing to do in terms of abstaining from something, doing something. You live your life as a Christian. But in today's climate, what's the meaning of being a Christian? The Christians of old, they followed laws, they followed the commandments, they applied the teachings of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam in their lives, and they devoted themselves in intensive worship, not just in the church and chosen selected days, but also at home. These days, and I'm only quoting what you hear from the ministries, from the pulpit, what you hear many of the leading evangelists say. Now they don't talk about sin. They don't even believe in the concept of sin. It's okay for people to live together before marriage. Forgive me for using the expression, but now it's acceptable to have same-gender marriages. There's no, according to some Christians, i.e. we're talking about the clergy, they don't even believe in the concept of hell anymore. And I was reading a magazine, I believe it was a Time magazine, and there was a whole section on Christianity in the US, in America. And they were interviewing some leading evangelists, and one of the evangelists said, look, those days have gone now of the church, when churches are dark, dull, and gloom, and where the priest was thundering away from the pulpit about sin and damnation. Those days have gone. Now you have beautiful churches, lots of glass, lots of light, lots of glitz, and now it's all about love and hope. Nobody talks about sin anymore. Nobody talks about damnation anymore. Nobody talks about hell anymore. Nobody even talks about salvation anymore. And these are his words. He said, we only talk about heaven because everybody is going to heaven, and the only thing that we discuss is how high you will be in heaven. Apart from that, listening to a lot of hopeful talk, there's no other meaning to being a Christian. There's nothing to do, no food to abstain from, no. If living together before marriage is now officially condoned and sanctioned, except in a few denominations, then what is left? So, people go to church once a week, even the very devout, and they feel they've done their duty. They come away and they feel they are cleansed and purified, ready for another week of sin. And God is merciful, God is loving, caring, forgiving, compassionate. Come next week, back to church, 1 or 2 hours of worship, and they feel purified again. There are many people of different faiths who do the same. They go to their place of worship, be it a church, a synagogue, a temple, a kingdom hall, some place to gather and congregate once a week, engage in a few rituals, sing a few songs, shed a few tears, and you come out and you're fresh. Otherwise, that's all religion is, for 1 or 2 hours in a church, in a place of worship on a chosen day. And for the rest of the week, you can live the way you want. You can eat the way you want. You can eat what you want, drink what you want, dress the way you want, live the way you want, earn how you want, dispense with your wealth how you want. There's nothing else expected of you. And unfortunately, being influenced by such cultures, being influenced by such attitudes, many Muslims have developed the same mentality. The whole idea of being a Muslim is that you go to the masjid once a week, in Jumu'ah. You can't miss Jumu'ah. And if you go to Jumu'ah, then mashallah, you are pious, you are muttaqi, you are devout, you are fully practicing. Once a week you go for Jumu'ah. You go, and wallahi, I have heard this sentence from Muslims themselves. Muslim men and Muslim women. Muslim men and Muslim women. I've heard this sentence myself. That Friday is the day of forgiveness. That means you sin for the rest of the week, and on Friday you go to the masjid, pray your Jumu'ah, do istighfar on Allah with Allah. So you go to Jumu'ah once a week. You perform your Surah al-Salah, and then you come out. Alhamdulillah. You cleanse, you purify, you forgive them, you're fresh, and you don't need to do anything else. Come next week, you come for Jumu'ah again. And people sometimes, in order to prove that they are practicing and that they are observant of the Islamic faith, they tell you, alhamdulillah, I pray my Jumu'ah. I pray my Jumu'ah. Even though And then the rest of the week, what do you do? You pray your Jumu'ah and Salah, that's it, just like everybody else. You then live the way you want to. You earn how you want, you spend your wealth the way you want, you dress how you want, you eat what you want, you drink what you want. That is no deen. That is no religion. That's the mockery of Allah's religion. And our whole understanding of religion, our perception of religion, is based on alien ideas, not on what Allah and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say. If you look at Salah, Jumu'ah Salah, compared to any other Salah, you have one Jumu'ah Salah, and you have 34 other Farz Salah during the week. People neglect all 34, and they are very, very diligent and observant about one Jumu'ah Salah. In fact, it's probably because of that one weakness, and then you get those who say, I go to the masjid, I pray my two Eid Salah. No Jumu'ah, but I pray my Eid Salah. And it's true. How many Muslims do we see in Fajr? How many Muslims do we see in Asr, Maghrib? Then how many Muslims do we see in Jumu'ah? And how many Muslims do we see in Ramadan? Even in Ramadan, we don't see as many Muslims that appear on Eid. On Eid, there's no space anywhere. Each masjid in places holds four or five different Jama'at. The Muslims are crawling out of the woodwork on Eid, and then they disappear again. And there was a very funny experience back in the UK in 1999, on August 11th, if you remember, there was an eclipse. On August 11th, 1999, there was an eclipse. So, as you know, alhamdulillah, well, it's a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when there is an eclipse, he himself called the people, led salah, and delivered a khutbah after salah, and he's encouraged the Muslims to do the same. But whenever there is an eclipse, then resort to prayer and seeking istighfar. And this salah is especially known in the terminology of Islam as salat al-kusuf, the salat of the eclipse. So, because the eclipse had been calculated from before that there will be an eclipse on such a day at such a time, many masajid and many ulama all over the world, and in the UK as well, they had reminded people that instead of going out and gawking at the sun at the time of the eclipse, you should do what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told you to do. Just come to the masjid and resort to prayer and istighfar. So, after the eclipse, a few days later, I was talking to a few people and they were all relating their experiences to me about Salat al-Kusuf in their local masjid. And one group of people told me about a Muslim, well, someone who calls himself a Muslim. He owns a shop right next to the masjid. He owns a shop right next to the masjid. Now, one wall divides his shop with the masjid. One wall. So they share one wall. Right next door, adjacent, there's no space. You come out of the masjid and the wall continues and then you enter the shop. Right next door. It's like another room. Perfect. He doesn't attend a single salah in the masjid. A single salah. He doesn't even attend Jumu'ah. Jumu'ah salah is being performed and he's standing in a shop next to it. A single salah he doesn't attend, not even Jumu'ah. For Allah's sake, he never even used to perform Eid salah. And so these brothers said to me that on that day, on Salat al-Kusuf, the salah was about, the eclipse was 11:11 in the morning. When they held the Salat al-Kusuf, they were just commenting that so many people turned up. It's like even that shopkeeper came. Even the shopkeeper came to Salat al-Kusuf, to the Salat of the eclipse. So they actually asked him. They said, you don't come for Jumu'ah, you don't come for Eid. So his reply was, Eid still comes twice a year, you know, you've got a chance. This is a once in a lifetime opportunity. a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Now, we may laugh at sin. We should laugh at ourselves. Because we have got the same silly attitude when it comes to Jum'ah. What Jum'ah Salah? 34 Farah Salah during the week. 5 Farah Salah of every day. And the 4 Farah Salah of Jum'ah on Friday. Look at the comparison in the Sharia. Take any of these, any one of these 34 prayers, any one. A Fajr of any day, a Zuhr of any day, Asr of any day, take any one. For the purpose of understanding, let's take Zuhr Salah, which is at the same time in the afternoon of any other day, compared to Jum'ah. Jum'ah is an obligation. Only upon certain people, not on everyone. Jum'ah is not an obligation on the traveler. If you're traveling, you still have to pray Dhuhr. But Jum'ah is not farad upon you. Jum'ah is not farad upon a sick person, someone who's so ill that he is unable to go to the masjid to perform Jumu'ah Salah. Jumu'ah is not farad upon him. Zuhr still remains farad upon him. So much so that he can be bedridden. The obligation of Jumu'ah Farad Salah is not dropped. There is no confession. He cannot rise even to relieve himself. And he is bedridden. He cannot touch water, fine, do tayammum. But he must still perform Zuhr Salah, not standing, if not sitting, if not lying on his head with the movements of his head. Jum'ah is not an obligation upon those who are old in age. They may be sick. They may be sick, i.e. in the center. They can walk. But because they are so old, it's not really expected of them that they can walk or travel to the masjid to perform Jum'ah Salah. Weak in that regard, Jum'ah is not part of it. Do you know, Jum'ah is only an obligation upon the inhabitants of the city according to all the scholars of Islam without exception. Jum'ah is only an obligation upon the inhabitants of the city according to all the scholars of Islam without exception. The only difference of opinion is, how do you define the borders of the city? That's all. And all the ulama agree that once you define the borders of the city, there's a difference of opinion as to how you define those borders. Beyond those borders, a man can be a strong 25-year-old, healthy individual, but because he lives outside the borders of the city, Jumu'ah is not an obligation upon him. Check, that is a matter. That is according to all the schools of thought. And Jumu'ah is not farad upon a traveler, even though he may be healthy. Let's say someone comes from another city here. He comes for business. He comes for business during Jumu'ah Salah on Friday. Jumu'ah Salah can be taking place here. But because he is a traveler, he is under no obligation to come and join the Salah in this masjid. He can actually be trading just half a mile down the road. Because he's a traveler, according to all the Imams of Fiqh, all the scholars of Islam, Jum'ah is not an obligation upon him, but it's an obligation for everybody else. He only has to pray Zuhr. So many confessions for Jum'ah Salah. But compare that to Zuhr. Allahu Akbar. Even on the battlefield, Zuhr is not forgiven. You can't even delay Zuhr on the battlefield. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum would split their salah as is mentioned in the Quran. And splitting their salah behind Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they would even pray on their horses, on the mount. That is the degree of obligation for every one of these other 34 prayers of the week. And as far as Jum'ah is concerned, there is confession after confession after confession. Jum'ah is not an obligation upon women at all. No obligation whatsoever. Healthy, young, fit, doesn't matter. Jumu'ah is not an obligation upon women. to every other salah. Now, when we compare these rules, what's more important? By every stretch of the imagination, by every standard and account, any one of these 34 prayers is far more important, far more greater an obligation than Jum'ah. Yet, look at our attitude and our approach. Everybody considers Jum'ah to be more greater of an obligation than any other prayer. We neglect all 34 prayers during the week and we perform Jumu'ah Salah and we think, well, alhamdulillah, that's our religion, that's deen. Why do you go to the masjid on Jumu'ah for? Because Allah has told me to. That's a sign of being a Muslim. It's not the only sign of being a Muslim. Allah has told you to perform Jumu'ah, but more importantly, Allah has told you to perform the other 34 prayers that week. This mentality of once a week going to the synagogue, the church, the temple, the masjid, that's alien. Once a week. And again, this attitude that you go once a week, you purify yourself, you cleanse yourself, you're ready for another week of sinning, then you come back the next week. No. And, even more importantly, once you perform your Jumu'ah, you can't spend the rest of the week as you want, i.e. you're only a Muslim for 2 hours or for an hour on Friday. For the rest of the week, you are expected to live like a Muslim in every sense of the word. And that leads me to the title. That, you know, we aren't just expected to pray as Muslims. We aren't just expected to drink as Muslims and to eat as Muslims. We are expected to pray, to worship as Muslims, to eat, to drink, to dress, to think, to feel, to sit, to rise, to sleep, to earn, to spend. Every single thing we are expected to change our personality, our attitude, our mentality, our philosophy, our way of thinking, our outlook on life, our approach, our dress code, our diet, every single thing we are expected to change and modify so that it conforms to the laws of Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not just our worship, dress, diet, code, even thinking, even mentality, even emotion. Allah, yes, Allah has told us how we should feel, what we can feel and what we can't feel. Allah has told us what we can think, what we can't think. Being Muslim stretches all the way from ibadah to every other part of his life. His character, his conduct, his approach, his mannerism, his speech. There are thoughts that are haram, there are words that are haram, there are modes of speech that are haram. And look at the Quran. The Quran doesn't tell us pray and that's it, it's okay. Riba is haram, pork is haram, alcohol is haram, gambling is haram, and salah, zakah, hajj, and fasting are all farz and that's it, you're a Muslim. Look at the Quran, Allahu Akbar. Allah has gone to great lengths to explain what we can think of and what we can't. سوء الظن يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن إن بعض الظن أو believers abstain from excessive speculation for some instances of conjecture and speculation are a sin. You cannot be suspicious about another Muslim. Now suspicion doesn't even involve emotion, it's just a thought process in the mind. But it's haram, Allah says you can't even be suspicious. You cannot entertain an unfavorable or a dishonest opinion about your fellows. Speech. Allah has told us what we can say, what we can't say. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa sallam emphasized so much. Look at the Quran, look at the hadith. Lying is haram. Slander is haram. Backbiting is haram. Gossip is haram. Namima is haram. Namima means gossiping and sowing the seeds of discord by carrying tales of one party to the other. All of these are haram. So Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us how to be a Muslim in every sense of the word. Not just worshipping for 1 hour a week, going to the masjid once a week. And even if a person performs his salawat and his prayers regularly, his Islam does not stop there. We are expected to become a Muslim in every way. In diet, in dress, in appearance, in mannerisms, in character, conduct, even in our thoughts, emotions and philosophy. We can't even feel a certain way according to every other way of life, every other ideology, every other philosophy. It's okay for you to feel jealous and envious. Islam says envy is just an emotion. It's an emotion. jealousy and envy are an emotion. That emotion is haram. You cannot even feel it. Malice is an emotion. You cannot feel that. Hatred is an emotion. It may be natural. What could be more natural to a human being than the emotions that a human being experiences? That's probably the most difficult thing to control. It's impossible. It's deep within. One of the people say we can't control our heart. True. But Allah has also still helped us. Well, it's not entirely true that you can't control your heart. That initial impulse is there. But Allah tells you that if that initial impulse is haram, then you must regulate it, curb it, curtail it, and if possible, eradicate it. You can't be envious. It's a pure emotion. You can't be hateful. It's a pure emotion. You cannot be spiteful. It's a pure emotion. You cannot be arrogant. You cannot be contemptuous. You cannot be judgmental. These are all partly emotional, partly mental. All of these are the dictates of Islam when it comes to the innermost thoughts and the deepest feelings of the heart, the deepest emotions of the heart. So, you know, a Muslim is not just a Muslim by praying Salah. A Muslim is one who is Muslim in every sense of the word. He has a whole character and personality about him. And that means that personality includes character, conduct, appearance, even mentality. Islam has told us what we can believe, what we can't believe. We have to have a mentality. Look at Surah Al-Ahzab. In the very beginning of Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has actually instructed the believers to rid themselves of superstition and superstitious beliefs. You cannot believe in superstition. It's not just a harmful old tale. Many superstitious beliefs are part of folklore, legends, and culture. Many of us think that these are harmless. It's okay to be superstitious. Look, it doesn't mean anything. Islam doesn't have to say anything about being superstitious. Walk beneath a ladder. You can't walk beneath a ladder. Why not? It's bad luck. Don't look in the mirror in a certain way. Don't shake your leg in a certain way. Don't scratch your ear in a certain way. If you're sneezing, somebody's remembering you. If you're coughing, somebody's remembering you. If you're hiccuping, somebody's remembering you. Oh, these are just innocent sentences, innocent superstitious beliefs. Islam has something to say about all of us. Every one of them. The Arabs were part of this superstition. They would release birds. They flew to the right, they'd draw a good omen. If they flew to the left, they would draw an ill omen. And sometimes they'd poke the bird in their nest. The birds would fly off, they'd observe which direction would they fly. And they would draw their augurs and their omens from them. The Arabs had many superstitious beliefs. This happens, that happens. They would believe, they had a belief about Hama. Hama means the skull, the skeleton, or the spirits of the dead. That when the dead would pass from this world, their spirits would roam the world in the bodies of birds, and especially owls. Now these were just apparently innocent superstitious beliefs, old wise tales. But Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have something to say about all of them. In fact, in Surah Al-Ahzab, you may find this rather strange. Allah is saying in the very beginning, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ اتَّقِ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُطِعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا وَاتَّبِعْ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. What does that mean? Allah says, O Prophet of Allah, fear Allah, and do not obey the disbelievers or the hypocrites. Verily Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. And follow that which is being revealed to you from your Lord. Indeed, Allah is well aware of what you are doing. And rely and trust only in Allah. And Allah is sufficient for God. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِّنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. Allah has not created two hearts in the one bosom of any man. Allah has not created two hearts in the bosom of any man. The Arabs had this superstitious belief that if anybody was highly intelligent, very capable, had an imposing personality, was very successful and a high achiever, they used to believe superstitiously about him that he never had one heart, he used to have two hearts. And there were a number of people in Makkah and Medina of whom it was believed, because of their success, their achievements, their imposing personality, their intelligence, that these people have two hearts, not one. And there was one person who actually boasted in Medina, he used to boast among Muslims, that I've got two hearts. And I see and I think with both of them. He used to say, I think with both of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِّنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. Allah has not created two hearts in the bosom of any man. وَمَا جَعَلَ أَزْوَاجَكُمْ اللَّائِي تُظَاهِرُونَ مِنْهُنَّ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ قَوْلُكُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَقُولُ الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ يَهْدِي السَّبِيلَ. Beautiful. Allah speaks about superstitious beliefs. Then Allah says, those women that you liken to the backs of your mothers are in reality not your mother. And nor has Allah made your adopted son your true son. These are mere statements of yours with your mouth. And Allah has with us who speaks the truth and he who guides the path. Three things. Superstitious beliefs, one. And this cultural belief that they have, that if you liken your wife to your mother's back, then she becomes haram for you. It was a means of separation for them. It was a certain wording of divorce. Because they used to believe that if you call someone your son, you've called him your son once, he becomes your son. You say to someone, you are my brother, he becomes your brother. You say to someone, you are my daughter, she becomes your daughter. Then she, as your adopted daughter, or he as your adopted son, take on the role of your real blood son and daughter. As a result, they inherit your wealth. They become part of the family. Every law that applies to your blood children applies to them. That was their cultural belief. And with regards to their wives, with their cultural belief that you cannot compare your wife to your mother. If in any way you say something or you use a certain wording that compares your wife to your mother, that's it. Just as your mother is sacred and haram to you, similarly your wife becomes haram to you. Now these were cultural beliefs, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned them, Allah removed them, and Allah said, none of these hold any truth, none of these stand whatsoever, they have no validity. In fact, you can, even if you compare your wife to your mother's, they are not your true mothers, despite your saying. And even if you adopt children, they do not become your true children. Despite your claims and despite your statement, these are mere words from your mouth. Because Allah has not really made these women your mothers, nor has Allah made these children your true children. Now, you know, there are many other verses of Surah Al-Ahzab that follow this, that adopt the same theme. That you can only accept something if it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this leads us to the beginning verses. Those verses are amazing. Allah addresses the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah tells him, O Prophet of Allah, fear Allah and do not obey the disbelievers or the hypocrites. Follow only Allah. No one else. Follow neither the hypocrites nor the disbelievers. وَاتَّبِعْ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. And follow that law or that revelation that has come to you from your Lord. That's it. You can only follow the Sharia. And that Sharia will tell you everything, including what you should believe, what you can't believe, including what's acceptable, what's unacceptable, including what you should think and what you should feel. Follow nothing but the Sharia of Allah. Allah tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, follow only that which has been revealed to you from your Lord. Now there are many other verses of the Qur'an. I was just using these as examples in order to demonstrate that Allah has told us what to think and what not to think. We can't believe in cultural traditions and beliefs and superstitions if they have no basis or reality. We can't just say, oh, okay, look, some people believe that he has two hearts. Today, because of medicine and because of technology and science and learning, we find that rather bizarre. But in those days, because they never knew so much science, Even then, no one could just say that, oh, this is an innocent statement, an innocent superstitious belief. No. Similarly today, we can't believe in superstition. Now, some people may say, well, what has superstition got to do with being a Muslim? I'm just using this as an example that something as innocent, apparently as innocent, as a pure superstitious belief. No. In Islam, Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us what to believe, what to think, how to dress, how to act, everything. Even the deepest thoughts. And Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam in the ahadith is condemning superstition. So much so that in one hadith mentioned, man tatayyara faqad ashra. Whoever draws an omen from these birds, or even not just from birds, but from any other source, whoever draws an omen from something, he has committed shirk. He has committed shirk. And subhanAllah, you know the verse of the Quran in which Allah speaks about gambling and alcohol. الله عز وجل سيدا أيها الذين آمنوا إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان. And then two very long verses speaking about the evils of these four things. We all know this verse famously for gambling and for alcohol. Allah says, O believers, alcohol and gambling. والأنصاب, the altars of sacrifice, the stones and the slabs upon which animals are placed and slaughtered in the name of their gods, false gods and idols. This is the meaning of Ansar. Well, Islam. What's Islam? The arrows of divination. All of these things, ritsun min amal al-shaytan, are impurities from the works of shaytan. Allah has likened gambling and alcohol. Allah has put on one path, on one level, gambling, alcohol, the altars of sacrifice to these false gods, and Islam. What's Islam? Islam means arrows of divination. They used to have these holy men. People would go to them, and they used to draw omens and say, look, I need to travel. Should I travel tomorrow? Should I travel a week later? Should I embark on this journey or not? So these holy men would say, let me check for you. Take a lot of money. And then they used to have these arrows. And doing different things with these different arrows, these were known as Islam, the arrows of divination. They would divine an omen or an organ from these to determine whether the journey was good or bad. SubhanAllah, it may seem innocent, but Allah has likened Islam to gambling, to alcohol, and to the altar of sacrifice. And all this superstition is just to do with thought, with mentality. Yet, if it's Allah has made it haram, we cannot believe it whatsoever. So, being a Muslim involves much more than just praying salah and giving zakat. And we may laugh at superstition, but any other ideology, any other belief that has no basis in Islam, it's not Muslim. Living in a non-Muslim community, living in non-Islamic culture, undoubtedly, there are many philosophies, many ideas, many thoughts, many bits of, shall we say, philosophy or outlook on life that are all baseless and have no position in Islam. Yet not only do we believe in them, we follow them, we adhere to them, and we mold our lives before them. The lesson is, as Muslims, we have to be Muslim in every sense of the word. Character, attitude, mentality, only then can a Muslim develop a proper Islamic personality. Only then. Look at that hadith, Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa salam says, he was asked, Ayyul Muslimina khayr? Who of the Muslims is the best Muslim? Who of the Muslims is the best Muslim? Famous hadith. Many authors have quoted this. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimun min lisanihi wa yadihi. Who is a Muslim, Ya Rasulullah? According to one narration, who is a Muslim? According to other narrations, who of all the Muslims is the best? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the Muslim is he from whose tongue and from whose hand other Muslims remain safe. Now here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't speak that a Muslim being someone who, mashallah, prays so many salawat and gives so much zakat and has been to Hajj so many times and for Umrah so many times. I've repeated myself a number of on a number of occasions about this topic, about Islam isn't just about prayer and pilgrimage and charity. I mentioned in my first khutbah in the Jumu'ah Salah on Friday, I mentioned some aspects of it yesterday, and I'm repeating myself today. Why? There's a reason. I don't claim to know much, but from my short and in my small and short experience, one of the most dangerous things that I have seen in the Muslim community is delusion in religion. People not acting on Islam the way it should be acted, not believing entirely, not acting upon it entirely, yet still believing and thinking that they are doing good. And this attitude that we see in our Muslim community globally, there's no difference. You go to a village, it's the same. You come to the city, it's the same. You go to the east, it's the same. You come here to the west, it's the same. This attitude that Islam is just about salah and zakat and pilgrimage and prayer and charity. But after that, you can live the way you want, treat others the way you want, lie, commit sins of the flesh, commit sins of the tongue, commit sins of the heart and mind. It doesn't matter. As long as you say your salah and you give your zakat and you go for pilgrimage, alhamdulillah, you're a pious Muslim. That is no Islam. No Islam. Religion isn't just about prayer and pilgrimage. In fact, there's a very beautiful verse that describes that. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب. It is not birr. Birr to mean righteousness, piety, holiness. It is not birr. For the sake of simplicity, let's translate that as righteousness. It is not righteousness that you turn your faces towards the east or the west. Now, if we look at the context of this verse and the backdrop to its revelation, during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Jews in Medina and in other parts of Arabia, Khaybar, and other areas, and the Christians of Arabia, they were quite faithful. Like I said earlier in the very beginning, that traditionally, you know, they used to believe, they used to worship regularly, quite excessively. So they were very faithful, very observant and diligent in their faith. They were very formal, extremely formal. And they would pride themselves on their piety, and they would regularly worship according to their prescribed method of worship. And even in Medina, the Jewish community wasn't a wayward community per se. They had a tradition of learning, of teaching, of pious practice according to them. They were strict about their dietary laws, about their dress code, about their dogma. Very, very strict. They were so strict that they even made haram upon themselves that which Allah hadn't made haram. Camel meat, Allah had never made haram. But the Jewish community in Medina and in Arabia in general, they were so observant, so diligent in their faith that they even made haram that which Allah hadn't made haram. So they even made camel meat haram upon themselves. So you get the picture. They were practicing, they were observant of their faith, they were very rigid, very assiduous in their observance of the laws of diet, dress, dogma, and religion. And they used to pride themselves on this. And the Jews traditionally, they would face Jerusalem when praying. And so would the Christians. They would normally, and I think many Eastern Orthodox, maybe not here, but certain many Christians in the eastern part of the world, I think they still do face Jerusalem, i.e. their intention is to face the Holy Sepulchre when praying and worshiping. فالله سبحانه وتعالى in this context saying ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب. It is not righteous that you face the east or the west. That's it. You turn to God in prayer and you think that that's holiness, that's pious. Even now you can see in Israel when Allah protects them from many of these innocent Palestinians are faced by these tanks and by these armored personal carriers. What happens? Many of these Jewish soldiers, very zealous and devout in their faith, before they launch an attack, they are rocking to and fro, performing their religious worship and their prayers. And then they march into battle. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's not righteousness that you face the east or the west in worship. And that's it. You turn to God in prayer and you think that you are holy and pious. You've established a direct connection and a personal one-to-one connection with God. Allah then continues. Allah defines righteousness. And now we Muslims can learn the same. It's for us as well. That religion, righteousness, piety isn't that you stand up for Salah and you face the Qibla. Or you face the east or the west or any direction that you may have to face in order to face the Qibla. And that's why you pray your Salah, Alhamdulillah, there is no one holier than you. We have that actually. Allah Azza wa Jalla defines righteousness for us in the following, in the remainder of the verse. Allah says righteousness isn't that you face the east or the west. You turn your faces towards the east or the west. وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ وَآتَى الْمَالَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ وَالسَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَى الزَّكَاةَ وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَاهَدُوا وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. الله says the name righteousness is of that person who believes in Allah and in the final day and in the angels and in the book and in the prophet. And who gives out in the love of Allah, to whom? To the relatives, his relatives, to the orphan, to the needy, to the traveler, to the beggar, and in the way you're freeing and emancipating slaves. And righteousness is of that person who establishes salah and who gives zakah. And righteousness is of those people who fulfill their promises and pledges when they do make promises. And righteousness is of those people who are patient and persevering in affliction, in hardship, and at the time of battle. These are the ones who are truthful to their words, and these are the ones who are taqwa. Religion, piety, isn't just standing up for salah, and that's it. Piety means, first of all, establishing the correct belief in Allah, and in the final day, in the angel, in the book, the Qur'an, in the Prophet of Allah. And then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't mention farz salah. He doesn't. Nor does he mention farz zakah. That comes later. Even farz zakah comes later. After correct belief in Allah, Allah defines righteousness by وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَىٰ. He gives wealth in the name and in the love of Allah to whom? ذَوِي الْقُرْبَىٰ, first and foremost to his relatives. First and foremost to his own relatives. To the orphan. To the needy. To the traveler. To the beggar. And in the way of queen, slave. And who establishes salah and gives zakah. That establishing salah and giving zakah is farz. That comes later. Before the farz salah and before the farz zakah, Allah mentions the person spending his wealth amongst his relatives. First and foremost amongst his relatives. Silat al-Rahim. Silat al-Rahim. Bonding the ties of kinship and blood in Islam. How important is that, subhanAllah? How important is it? It's mentioned in the Ahadith, Silat al-Rahim will take a form and cling onto the Arsh of Allah on the day of Judgment. And it would plead with Allah regarding those who have violated the requirements of Silat al-Rahim. Those with great ties with their family members. No, it's amazing. We are so hypocritical in our approach. And we have such an illogical and insensible and incongruous attitude to our religion. You know, we're all talking about unity. Oh, Muslims should unite. And we're all concerned about Muslims in Afghanistan, in Iraq, and in Palestine. And it's true, we should be united. And we should be concerned about Muslims in all of these places. But our illogical attitude knows no bounds. We're all concerned about Muslims 6,000-8,000 miles away that we've never met in our lives, we will never meet in our lives, yet the Muslim who is living next door to you, who prays Salah in the same masjid, and who prays, or who you know as your work colleague or your acquaintance, or in the locality, you don't give salam to him, he's in need, you don't help him, in fact, you slander him, you lie about him, you lie against him, you backbite him, you abuse him, you treat him like dirt, you hold him in contempt, you act as though he doesn't even exist. We talk about unity, and we break ties with our blood brothers. Blood brothers and blood sisters do not speak to one another. Uncles and nephews do not talk to one another. We talk about uniting the whole Ummah globally, and we aren't willing to fulfill the needs and the requirements of our own relatives. We're willing to send a check, or maybe give a few dollars here and there to some unknown, anonymous, suffering Muslims in another part of the world. We know that one of our relatives, even someone from the extended family, is in need of money, or for some strange reason, for something that may have happened 7 generations ago. 7 generations ago. Wallahi, astaghfirullah, if something happened, so one granddad looked at another granddad in a bad way. He gave him the eye, he gave him a cold look, that's it. Bitter and sworn enemies, their children do not forgive each other for 7 generations. Even though they may be blood relatives. And we're all concerned about unknown, anonymous Muslims in other parts of the world. SubhanAllah, righteousness, Allah gave him the وَأَقَامُ الصَّلَاةُ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةُ. Even before فَرُضْ صَلَاةُ and فَرُضْ زَكَاةُ, Allah speaks about righteousness, being of those people, the righteous people being those who spend in the way of Allah. But to whom? To the travelers, to the beggars, to the orphans. Even before the orphans, Allah says, ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى, to the relatives. And what's our attitude about the relatives? Thank God you can choose your friends. That's our attitude about relatives. Now thank God at least you can choose your friends. I'm numbered with this brother, with that sister, with that aunt, with that uncle. Thank God you can choose your friends. That's our attitude about relatives. Allahu Akbar. And Allah is the silatul rahim. Such an important part of religion. Allah mentioned this. ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى, even before the orphans, before the widows, or the widow, the word widow isn't mentioned here, but the orphans, or even before the orphans, even before the needy, the masakeen, and even wasa'ilin, even before the beggar, and even before freeing and emancipating slaves, such a noble task in Islam. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, spend, the one righteous are those who spend on their rest. Even before farz salah and farz zakah. And apart from farz salah and farz zakah, what else does Allah mention about righteous? وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَاهَدُوا. Those who fulfill their promises when they do make a pledge. Astaghfirullah. That's part of religion. Not like us. We think you can pray salah and give zakah and alhamdulillah, everything is forgiven. Everything is forgiven. We think going for hajj means that everything is forgiven. Astaghfirullah. What one person, I'll mention this fact. We think going for hajj forgives everything. We all know the hadith that when a person's hajj is accepted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives him. He returns home in such a pure state as though his mother has just given him birth, like a newborn baby. We all know those hadith. And people have this common belief that, mashallah, go for hajj, and hajj forgives all sins. Everything is forgiven. And, you know, that's why a lot of people have this plan. I'm going to earn now, I'm going to learn now, I'm going to study and educate myself, no need to practice, I'm going to start earning, build a career. And then people have this plan for 40, 50 years, just like my father and my father and my granddad before him. I'll cheat and I'll lie and I'll defraud and I'll steal and I'll pilfer money from others. And when I become grand and rich, and at the age of 50, inshallah, I'll become a haji, lengthen my beard, I'll go for hajj, all will be forgiven. and then I can come back and become a noble of the community. And then I can go onto the masjid board. Then, after 50 years, and then I'll start telling everybody how to live their religion, how to live their lives, and how to be a good Muslim. We plan. SubhanAllah. Allah actually says that in the Quran. وَلْيُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ وَلْيُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ Nay, man plans to sin ahead of himself. We actually plan our sins. So this attitude that Hajj will forgive everything, it doesn't. Hajj only forgives minor sins. Hajj does not forgive major sins. Salah does not forgive major sins. Zakah does not forgive major sins. And the ulama are unanimous in this. All those ahadith that speak about the forgiveness of sins refer to minor sins, not major sins. No major sin can be shed or forgiven, even by salah, even by zakah, even by hajj, without individual tawbah and repentance for every individual sin. Even hajj does not forgive. Every single hadith, remember this as a rule, every single hadith which speaks about the forgiveness of sins refers to minor. Never major. Every major sin requires individual tawbah and repentance. Every major sin. Salah cannot forgive major sins, even Hajj cannot forgive major sins. And then, even with these minor sins, Hajj, Salah, Zakah, Umrah, any of these fasting, they will only forgive those sins that are connected to Allah's obedience. That's right, Allah's disobedience. Where a person has violated the right of Allah. When a person violates somebody else's right, then Allah is too just to forgive him without the victim forgiving himself. It's mentioned in the hadith, a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, what does shahada forgive? Does shahada shed everything? Martyrdom in the way of Allah, does it forgive everything? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes. Even before the first drop of a martyr, the first drop of the blood of a martyr falls on the ground, Allah forgives all his sins. All his sins. So the man asked, Ya Rasulullah, does martyrdom, does shahada in the way of Allah forgive all of man's sins? The man said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes. The man walked away. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him, إِلَّا الدَّيْنِ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam summoned that man. Where is that man? Quickly call him. The man was brought back. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, إِلَّا الدَّيْنِ Except debt. Forgive everything except debt. Now, it doesn't just mean debt. The word debt refers to debt. But this is to be expanded and understood in a wider sense of the word, that any right that belongs to Allah, Allah will forgive it through shahada. Any right that belongs to any other Muslim, any violation of a right, even a debt or any other right that belongs to another Muslim, Allah will not forgive that, even with shahada, even with martyrdom in the way of Allah. So, you know, Allah says, "Mufuna bi'ahdihi idha 'ahadu," those righteousnesses and those who fulfill their pledges and promises when they do make a promise. That's part of doing, that's righteousness. Look, we defraud each other, we lie, we deceive, and we think that doesn't matter. There's no harm. As long as you establish your connection with Allah, you're okay. As long as you're a haji and a Muslim, alhamdulillah, then you can cheat, defraud each other, lie to each other, lie about each other. Astaghfirullah. That's not righteousness, that's not Islam. You know, like I was saying earlier, Islam isn't just about worship and prayer and pilgrimage and charity. Islam is about the whole character of being a Muslim. And I started this section of this talk by that hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, who is the Muslim or who is the best Muslim? He said, al-Muslimu man salima al-Muslimu min al-Islami. The Muslim is he from whose hunger and from his hand other Muslims remain safe. Now concentrate on this hadith. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi doesn't speak about salah or zakah or hajj or even ibadah. He says a Muslim, who's a Muslim? A Muslim is he from whose tongue and from whose hands other Muslims remain safe. And does he mention hands first? He mentions the tongue first. He mentions the tongue first. Allah. He mentions the tongue first. That saves Allah. We have adopted our mentality and our understanding and our perception of sin from non-Muslim world. See, this is what I'm trying to get at. That we have to think of Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even our perception of sin, our understanding of sin, are taken from non-Muslims. Can I tell you about how? The tongue and the hand. You know, non-Muslims have this attitude that, look, you can say what you want about someone, but you can't touch them. True? You can say what you want about someone, you can't touch them. And that's what Muslims do as well. Muslims say the same. You can lie, you can cheat, you can slander, you can backbite, you can swear, you can verbally abuse, you can verbally harass, you can say what you want. And you know, no one will bat an eye. So you've got two people, one guy standing there, and it's not the first time either. The other one's saying, your mother's like this and your father's like that, and you like this and you that. One day, second day, third day. Nobody bats an eyelid, everybody was saying, two guys arguing. They're not arguing, one's arguing, the other's listening. One's swearing and abusing, the other's listening. One day, after many, many days of abuse, that victim loses his mind. He just loses control, he slaps the other. Suddenly everybody converges around him. Astaghfirullah, you hit the Muslim brother. That's haram, don't you know? His body is sacred, his blood is sacred. Haram, astaghfirullah, a Muslim does not hit another Muslim. That's our attitude. And we say, hey, brother, look, he isn't saying that one. Brother, sticks and stones break bones, words never heard. We learned this from Playground. Sticks and stones break bones, but words never hurt. Just talk with us, so what? Astaghfirullah, the Prophet said, they don't even quote the hadith. They say, what? Tufaluhu kufr. To battle with the Muslim is kufr. The hadith of Bukhari, Tufaluhu kufr. Astaghfirullah, you can't hit another Muslim, you can't touch another Muslim. Where do we get this mentality from? It's not from Islam, I'll tell you, it's not from Islam. It's not. It's from non-Muslim. Well, you can say what you want, but you can't touch it. I don't know what the laws are here in the UK. If you touch somebody else, they've got a whole list of laws. GBH, grievous bodily harm, section 18, assault. And you can get into some serious trouble for touching someone. But you can say what you want about it. I believe that's the case here as well. You can't touch anyone. No way. You can say what you want about it. I'll tell you how far. And we Muslims have taken from the members in this country, the US, many years ago, not too many years ago, in the 1970s, there was a maverick publisher, magazine publisher. You know what he did? He wanted to boost sales of his magazine. Stuck with the lights, it's rather poisonous, what I've got to say. He wanted to boost the sales of his magazine. So there's nothing like scandal to promote the media, one's magazines. So he took out an advertisement in one of his magazines. You've all heard of Jerry Falwell, famous evangelist. And let me speak about it from a Christian perspective, from a non-Muslim perspective. Jerry Falwell, I said this from a non-Muslim perspective. Jerry Falwell, even in the 1970s, he was regarded as being a very senior Christian, a leading evangelist, a well-respected figure in the community, a devout Christian. So this maverick publisher, I can't remember his name or his network, he decided to publish a magazine, and in that magazine, in order to boost sales, he wanted to create some controversy and a scandal. He took out a full-page advertisement in which he said that Jerry Falwell, astaghfirullah, committed incest with his own mother. Jerry Falwell committed incest with his own mother in the backyard, in the back house. Astaghfirullah, the Christian groups are wild. What do? They sued him. That's exactly what he wanted. They sued him. He lost the case. He took it to a higher court of appeal. He won. They sued him again. He took it to a higher court. They sued him again. Took it to a higher court. Sued him again. Finally, this case, a stupid case, found its way to the Supreme Court of America. And as you know, here in the Supreme Court, in the US, Supreme Court of America is God's law. So the case went to the Supreme Court. A stupid case. He actually went to the Supreme Court of America. What was the final blessed and holy ruling of the Supreme Court of America? You won't believe it. The Supreme Court of America ruled. And after that, there's no appeal, is there? There's no appeal. That's it. ما يبدل القول لديه. After that, there's no abrogation, there's no modification, there's no appeal, that's it. So the Supreme Court of America ruled that even with regard to Jerry Falwell, says it is the right of this defendant under the First Amendment of the Constitution as part of his freedom of speech to be able to say what he wants. Because he claimed he was saying it in satire as a joke. That it's okay for him to joke and to say in a satirical manner, even about Jerry Falwell, a leading Christian evangelist, that he committed incest with his own mother in the backyard. And you can go and check. That's the ruling, and it stands all the same. It stands all the same. Astaghfirullah. You can't touch someone, but you can falsely accuse him as a joke of having committed zina with his own mother. And that's sanctioned by the Supreme Court of America. Now, we have taken same and strength from non-Muslims. Brother, don't lay a finger on him. He can say what he wants about Islam. That's haram. Islam doesn't recognize that. Islam has a lot to say. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min al-Islam. A Muslim is he from whose tongue, first of all, not his hands, from his tongue. From his tongue, other Muslims, and from his hands, other Muslims remain safe. In fact, Islam is a completely different take on it. It's not good that someone hits another. I'm sorry. We've got to take everything into consideration. You do. There's a hadith that demonstrates this. Listen very, very carefully and try to understand it. In the hadith raised by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إن من أكبر الكبائر أن يلعن الرجل والديه. قيل يا رسول الله كيف يلعن الرجل والديه؟ قال يسب الرجل أبا الرجل فيسب أباه وأمه. أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم Indeed, إن من أكبر الكبائر One of the greatest of the major sins. Meaning, amongst the major sins, one of the greatest of these major sins is that a man curses his own parents. So the Sahaba asked, Ya Rasulullah, how can a man curse his own parents? How can a man curse his own parents? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a man abuses the father of another man. A man abuses the father of another man. So he in retaliation, and he in turn, he abuses this person's father and mother. So subhanAllah, he abusing the person's father and mother, yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam blames the victim and says, it is one of the greatest sins, of the major sins, that he curses his own parents. He hasn't cursed them, he's a victim of his parents being cursed. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, he started it. He cursed the other's father. Now it's all, you know, the idea is that, look, it's all very good and noble to say that, astaghfirullah, you shouldn't retaliate. You shouldn't answer back. You should turn the other cheek. You should learn to forgive. You should be patient. Don't be angry. We all preach that. That's what Islam preaches. But we've got to take human nature into consideration. We have to take human nature into consideration. And it's inevitable. You provoke someone, he's going to be provoked. You mess around with someone, he's going to get angry. You push someone to desperation, he's going to adopt desperate measures. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, this man, for no reason, he abused the other's father. So that person didn't just remain silent, nor did he retaliate in kind by saying, oh, you say my dad is like that, well, your dad is like that. No, he went one step further, so your dad and your mum are like that. And yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, who's responsible? Who is responsible? The one who started. SubhanAllah, the one who started. He's committed one of the most major of sins, the greatest of the major sins. That he has been the cause of his own parents being cursed. So Islam has a completely different take on a lot of things. Our understanding is different. We take our perception of sin from other people. Al-Muslim wa man salim al-Muslim wa man salim wa man salim. A Muslim is he from whose tongue, first of all, not his fist and not his hand, but whose tongue, from whose tongue, and then his hand, other Muslims remain safe. Wallahi, there's a great lesson for us in that. This leads me back to the topic, which is, I'm not veering off, this is all connected. That's a Muslim. That is an Islamic personality. He is a Muslim in dress, in diet, in code, in dogma, in belief, in doctrine, in the character, in conduct. He is a Muslim even in tongue. Even by tongue. Wallahi, Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us how to speak. We have been taught and educated as to how to speak. What to say, what not to say. Not just that, oh, it's haram for you to say that, it's halal for you to say that. No. Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us how to speak. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam demonstrated to us how we should speak. We should, first of all, only open your mouth when you have to. Silence is always better. Silence is better. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in hadith, man samata maja, he who remains silent saves himself. He was safe. He who remained silent was safe. Sayyidina Uqbah ibn Amir radiyallahu ta'ala anhu went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, man najah, what is salvation? How did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answer him? What is salvation? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, amsik alayka lisan. Amsik alayka lisan. Wal yasa'ka baytuk wabki ala khatiyah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered him, though, you want to know what salvation is? Three things. First and foremost, amsik alayka lisan, withhold your tongue. Control your tongue. Remain in the confines of your home and weep over your sins. In a long hadith later by Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, in his sunan, Sayyidina Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, I was traveling with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's a long hadith around our time. We were traveling, so I saw an opportunity that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alone. So I brought my horse close to him and I came up so close to him that my knees were touching the knees. My thighs were touching the thighs of Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam. That was their love. You know, they would comment on how my palm was in between the two palms of Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Masud radiyallahu anhu, he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaching the shackles and my hand would be in between the two hands of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. Some people say that's the evidence that you should only shake hands with one hand. You should only shake hands with one hand. So the Prophet, the Sahabi says, my one hand was in between me, two hands of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. How they draw such conclusions, astaghfirullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, okay, even if you just look at it very crudely, that Abdullah ibn Masud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he extended one hand. One hand. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had two. My hand was in between the two hands of Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam. We are disrespectful. Can it be imagined of Abdullah ibn Masud radiyallahu anhu, that he would be so disrespectful that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is extending both of his hands and Abdullah ibn Masud is extending one hand. And even if for argument's sake you say, fine, there's only one hand. Whose sunnah do you want to follow? The sunnah of Abdullah ibn Masud or the sunnah of Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam? Truth is, عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه send them both his hands. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم both his hands. But like anybody who meets with both hands, one palm is in between the other two. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه saying with love and pride that my one hand was in between the two hands of Rasulullah عليه الصلاة. My thighs, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal رضي الله عنه saying, my thighs were touching the thighs of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's the love of the Sahaba رضي الله عنه would sit, and the Sahaba would catch the spit before it fell on the ground and anoint their faces with the saliva of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. They would drink his blood. One Sahabi رضي الله عنه came, he was told to dispose some of the blood of Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام. He went and drank it. And he came back and informed Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, what did he say? Did he rebuke him? Allah Akbar. He said, never will the fire of Jahannam touch that body which is mixed with my blood. Now, the wives of Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام would collect his sweat and perspiration and use it as if. Using it personally. How was the love of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu? So Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu says, my thighs were touching the thighs of Rasulullah alayhi sallam. I mean, what's the reason for mentioning something like that? How was their love, their pride? And I saw an opportunity to speak to him, so I came close to him, so close that night. I was riding, he was riding, my thighs were touching his thighs. And then I said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, tell me something in Islam that will take me close to Jannah and take me far away from Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, O Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, لقد سألت عن عظيم وإنه ليسير على من يسره الله عليه. O Mu'adh, indeed you have asked about something great, one thing which will take you close to Jannah and lead you away from Jahannam. You've asked about something great, but O Mu'adh, it's easy for whom one Allah makes. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned a few things. Salah, tahajjud, iman, fasting, jihad in the way of Allah. He mentioned all of these good deeds, some of the pillars of Islam. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, O Mu'adh, ala ukhbiruka biminati dhalika kullih. O Mu'adh, should I not inform you of something that encompasses and incorporates all of the above? So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu said, bala ya Rasulullah, of course. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam physically watched rising. He took hold of his own tongue and pulled it out in this manner. Meaning, O Mu'adh, more important than jihad, more important than salah, more important than fasting, more important than tahajjud, all of these things that I mentioned before in the upper part of the hadith, earlier part of the hadith, more important than all of this, one thing which encompasses and incorporates all of these things is, he didn't even speak, Rasulullah alayhi sallam pulled out the tongue with his own noble finger. So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, will we be seized by Allah and taken to task and held to account for what our tongues utter? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O Mu'adh, I thought you were one of the most intelligent people of Medina. وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسَ فِي النَّارِ عَلَىٰ وُجُوهِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ O Mu'adh, there is nothing else that throws people sweat on their faces in the fire of Jahannam other than the harvest of their tongues and meat. He called it harvest. Harvest, right? When someone's harvesting their crops, what do? They gather everything first. Then everything sifted and cleaned and distinguished afterwards. You know, the wheat from the chaff from the wheat and the corrupt from the fresh and good. So all of that is separated afterwards. But initially, the harvest is collected in one go. So dry and wet and good or bad, corrupt and edible and corrupt and inedible or edible and good, everything is just collected together. Nobody cares. It's all sorted out afterwards. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described the tongue as something that sweeps the harvest along. Haram, halal, good, bad, evil, impure, pure. That's the tongue. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is nothing more that throws people flat on their faces into the fire of Jahannam other than the harvest of their tongue. So going back to what I was saying, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a Muslim is he from whose tongue other Muslims remain safe. You know, this tongue is so destructive to some people. Allah has told us how to talk, what to talk, what to say, even when to speak, what not to speak. First of all, remain silent. In a long hadith, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, recorded by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, and Imam Sahih, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir, falyukrim dhayfah. Wa man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir, fala yu'zi jarah. ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says whoever believes in Allah on the final day then let him honor his guest. Whoever believes in Allah on the final day let him not hurt and trouble his neighbor. And whoever believes in Allah on the final day let him say something good otherwise hold his silence. If you've got nothing to say don't say anything. Best remain silent. And when you do speak let it be pure and good. Allah says, وَحُدُوءِ لَطَيِّرٍ لَلْقَوْلِ And they have been guided, the believers, to the most pure of speech. The most pure of speech. And in many hadith, Allah subhanahu you know the speech, speech has an effect on your actions. Allah subhanahu says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا Oh believers, fear Allah and say an upright word. Meaning when you speak, speak in an upright manner. Speak properly. And what happens when you speak properly? If you speak in an upright manner, how will Allah reward you? يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ Allah says, oh believers, fear Allah and say an upright word. What will Allah do in return? Allah will make your deeds good and pure. If you want to know, many people ask, how do I become pious? How do I become close to Allah? How do I achieve the love of Allah? How do I become closer to Allah? How do I become practicing? How do I achieve steadfastness? Allah gives you the answer, one of the answers in one verse. Fear Allah, speak properly. Control your tongue, yuslih lakum a'malakum. Allah will make your deed good and pure. You want to become pious? Control your tongue. You control your tongue, Allah will guide your body. You control your tongue, Allah will make your body good. Allah will make your deeds good by the test of Allah. So, a Muslim is he from his hands, so from his tongue, and then from his hands, other Muslims remain safe. Allah has told us what to say, what not to say, how to speak. Speak with hands. No, speak softly. We are supposed to speak softly. In fact, Rasulullah would never raise his voice, he wouldn't shout, he wasn't one to scream in the market. But as a khadim to the swag, he wasn't one to scream or shout or raise his voice in the market. As softly spoken. Habar radiallahu ta'ala anhu were as such. Don't speak loudly. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one hadith he says, وَإِنَّ مِنْ أَبْغَضِكُمْ إِلَيْهِ وَأَبْعَدِكُمْ مِنِّي مَنْزِلَةٍ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الثَّرْثَارُونَ وَالْمُتَشَدِّقُونَ وَالْمُتَطَيِّفُونَ In the hadith of Ibn al-Tirmidhi in the Sunan, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, long hadith is on our time, so I won't mention it all. He speaks about those who will be the closest to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and on the day of judgment, in position, in rank, and who are the most beloved to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he said, who are they? Ahsanukum khulqa, those of you who are the best in rank. And then he says, وَإِنَّ مِنْ أَبْغَضِكُمْ إِلَيْهِ وَأَبْعَدِكُمْ مِنِّي مَنْزِلَةً يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ And indeed, from amongst you, those who are the most detested and resented to me, and those who are the furthest, who shall be the furthest away from me on the day of judgment are who? الثَّرْثَارُونَ الْمُتَشَدِّقُونَ الْمُتَّيْفُونَ Who are they? الثَّرْثَارُونَ Those who speak a lot. أستغفر الله. Those who speak a lot will be the furthest from Rasulullah on the day of judgment and They are most resented by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those who speak a lot. Speak excessively for no reason whatsoever. Yap, 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 and talk, talk, talk all the time. Some, as the Imam Sahib says, make themselves heard. Astaghfirullah. Mutafayhiqun means those who are arrogant in their speech. وَالْمُتَشَدِّقُونَ The middle one. You know what المُتَشَدِّقُونَ is? So the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, we know what الثَّرْثَارُونَ means. We know what المُتَشَدِّقُونَ means. Those who are angry. المُتَشَدِّقُونَ Who are the المُتَشَدِّقُونَ? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described them. those who affectate speech, those who imitate, simulate, and affectate speech. I.e., that's not their natural way of talking, but to impress, that's how they talk. So they adopt a certain accent in order to impress other people. Or they want to appear to be bad and cruel or wicked, so they talk in a certain manner. They adopt the language of the ghetto, or they adopt the language of the posh, they adopt the language of the upper class, they adopt the language of the rich. It's not their natural style, but that they adopt it in order to impress people. We may think it's an innocent act. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa salam says, those who speak unnaturally, they are the most detested to me, and on the day of judgment, this should be the furthest away from us. We have been told how to speak. Not just you can't lie, and you can't backbite, and you can't slander. Even when you're talking, don't raise your voice. Luqman alayhi salatu wa salam said to his son, وَغْضُضْ مِنْ صَوْتِكَ and lower your voice. إِنَّ أَنْكَرَ الْأَصْوَاتِ لَصَوْتُ الْحَمِيرِ indeed the most detested of all sounds is the sound of the donkey brain. Now those who talk loudly, the Qur'an has likened them to donkey brain. Someone's talking away loudly, loudly for no reason. Look, I'm only standing one foot away from you from last night. Loud in character, loud in approach, loud in speech. The Qur'an says it's just like donkeys dehorning. So we've been told, don't speak loud, speak soft. Speak soft. And then, when you speak, speak the best. Speak the most pure of things. And speak naturally. Speak the way Allah has created. Don't affectate your speech. Don't simulate your speech. Don't use big words in order to impress and imitate. Don't adopt a certain accent in order to impress and imitate. Speak as Allah has made you. Speak naturally and sincerely. That far. Do not speak excessively. Speak softly, in volume, in tone, and only speak as much as you need to. Do not speak excessively. Do not speak arrogantly. Allah has always, even the manner of speech has been taught to us. We've only covered part of what I would have liked to say. But this topic that, you know, as Muslims, we have an Islamic identity, we have an Islamic personality, we have an Islamic mentality, we have an Islamic attitude, we have an Islamic character, we have an Islamic mannerism, we have everything. And we are supposed to live as Muslims, believe as Muslims, think as Muslims, feel as Muslims, even our emotions should be religious. Feel as Muslims, speak as Muslims, dress and eat and drink as Muslims. Islam isn't just about worship. Oh, you worship as Muslims, and like everybody else then, for the rest of the week you can live and behave, talk and walk, and act and sit, and conduct yourself and carry yourself the way you want. Allah has told us everything. Even as much as how to speak with each other, how to deal with each other, and so much more. I pray even how to think. We have to think. Our understanding of sin should be that of Islam. As I was saying earlier, we've taken our perception of sin from non-Muslims. Non-Muslims say it's okay to, you know, say what you want about somebody else, but you can't touch them. We accept that. We adopt it and we live by it. Today, riba has become so common. It's considered to be the powerhouse of the world economy. Riba is considered to be the integral nucleus of the world economy. Oh, nothing can happen without interest in riba. So now, people abstain from alcohol, but it's okay. You can. Can indulge in riba. Gambling. Alcohol is haram. Gambling is okay. It is. Give it a different name and it's okay. The lottery is okay. Raffle ticket, it's okay. Astaghfirullah. Here is. In this country, there are massages that hold a raffle ticket outside the masjid after Eid Salah. That's gambling. Raffle ticket, gambling. I don't know if you've got the if you've got a national lottery here. Do you have a national lottery? Every state has its own lottery. In the UK, there wasn't a national lottery, but it was launched, I believe, I think it was in the early 80s, sometime in the 80s. There was a national lottery that was launched in the UK. We nicknamed it the National Lottery. Nobody wins. Yeah, the National Lottery. You're more likely to be hit by a meteorite than win the lottery. That's no joke. I'm not telling you in order to make you laugh. That was an official statistic they came out with. That you're more likely to be hit by an asteroid than win the lottery. One chance in 138 million of these things. So, you know, Muslims, when the lottery came out in the UK, the Muslims were lining up in the shopping mall. Hajis with beards and topis on their heads. And women in hijab lining up for the lottery. And they would give it all kinds of names. No, Maulana Saab, Imam Saab, no, it's okay. They're giving the money to charity, it's our contribution to charity. And it's a kind of trade, it's an investment. It's an investment. We give it all kinds of names. This is one of the prophecies in the hadith, that towards the day of judgment, many of these sins will be given different names. And people will try to legitimize them by giving them a different label. So, you know what? The same people who buy lottery tickets, if they went to the shopping mall and they said, okay, I'll have a packet of crisps, I think they call them chips, packet of crisps, I'll have a drink, and I'll buy a lottery ticket. Oh, would you like a can of lager as well? Astaghfirullah, don't you know I'm a Muslim? Don't you know I'm a Muslim? I don't drink. Subhanallah. It's okay, it's haram for you to drink. It's okay for you to buy a lottery. Even though the same verse that condemns alcohol condemns cancer. There's division in religion. So, you know, our understanding of sin is taken from the non-Muslims. According to the non-Muslims, riba is okay. That's why we say it's okay. Astaghfirullah, even though it's a major sin. In a hadith related by Ibn Majah in his Sunan, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, riba has 70 graves. 70, the lowest of which adnaha riba, al-riba 70 darajah, adnaha an yizni al-rajul bi ummi. Hadith of Ibn Majah. Riba 70 grades, the lowest of these 70 grades is that a man commits adultery with his own mother. So because riba is okay according to the non-Muslims, we've adopted that attitude, riba is haram. Drugs, Rasulullah, the greatest major sin, drugs. Even though drugs, why do we consider drugs to be so evil? Why? Because of the media, because of society. I'm not saying drugs are halal. All I'm saying is we are so vociferously against drugs. Not because Islam says so, because of the influence of the media, because of the influence of society. We take our conception of sin from the non-Muslims. Riba is a million times worse in the book of Allah than drugs. Yet, you know, the father's whole business runs on riba. The whole family's whole income is derived from riba. The family's house is based on riba. And then the father's lecturing the son about drugs. So where do we take our perception of sin from the moment? As a Muslim, we should be complete in our Muslim personality, including our attitude, our mentality, our outlook, our philosophy, even our perception of sin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq to understand. May Allah make us amongst those who are Muslim in every sense of the word. وصلى الله وسلم على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.